Hello. Can everyone hear me? Okay. So no response means everyone can hear me. So we'll start off this opportunities at CSA talk. Now, you already had a pretty nice introduction to the department given by Professor Narahari. And we approached doing this talk with some amount of trepidation. I mean, can we do better than that? So rather than what we'll try to do is we'll try to portray CSA not as a monolithic entity. There's a lot of things going on inside CSA. And we'll try to outline what goes on and how you can get into one of these various fields. So so we have four volunteers for this talk. I was very kindly supported by Arpita Biswas, who's an ME student at CSA, Shiv Ganesh, who is an ME student at SSA, Saneem, who is a MSc student, and I'm Shivam. So let's get started. So the rough outline of this talk, what we try to intend doing in this talk is to get you motivated about research, right? So I mean, research is something that probably not all of you are familiar with. We'll try to get you motivated about research. And if some of you are excited about taking up research, and in particular joining CSA, then we'll consider this endeavor a success. So we'll briefly talk about the history of CSA. And then we'll go on to the research areas, right? What are the areas on which we do research? And then we go on to the individual programs. So we have an ME program, the Master of Engineering program. We have an ME at SSA program, and Shiv Ganesh is going to elaborate on that. Then we have an MSc engineering program, and Saneem is going to elaborate on that. And finally, we have the PhD program, which I'll try to elaborate, and hopefully everyone will join the last one. But you're free to choose. I mean, that's what we're trying to do in this. We're going to give you all the facts. We're not trying to overwhelm you with facts. We're just giving you all the options. You be the judge, right? You try to figure out what's the best fit for you, right? So all you have to do is get a hold of what is done in these courses, how you can get in, and then try to get for yourself what's the best fit, right? And once you get into the best fit, you'll see that there are a lot of options to switch, right? And then you always have the options to upgrade or downgrade, or what are the placements opportunities. We'll give you everything, right? So you are the best judge. We're just going to give you the information. So let's, before we begin, let's just briefly discuss the history of CSA. So this department was established in 1969. It was called School of Automation. It's now called Computer Science and Automation. And it's recognized by the University Grant Commission as a center for advanced study, obviously. So the thing is, the top 100 papers which are cited, there are over 35,000 citations. So these are papers which others have used and reused, and these are results which are really groundbreaking. Otherwise, they wouldn't get these many citations. So we have a lot of high-impact papers coming from this department. So 35,000 citations is a big number for any university, any computer science department on the planet. And in the academic ranking of world universities, so in 2011 and 2012, we were in the equivalence class 101 to 150. This is a worldwide ranking. And in 2013, we went to the equivalence class 51 to 75. Now, the point to note is no other department in India comes even anywhere close to this range, right? So we are the only ones in the top 100. I believe the next one is in the 150s range or even later than that. So we also tend to play a very influential role in Bangalore's emergence as the IT capital. So Wipro was formed in ISC, in CSA in particular, and I'll outline some of the other companies which draw a lot of manpower from CSA. And these are the big companies and the big research labs. So we've recently been in the news. I don't know if you've been staying updated, but in the Times of India, you might have come across this piece of news that the Bangalore-based Strand Life Sciences creates an affordable cancer detection kit. Now, Strand Life Sciences was formed by four professors from the Electrical Sciences Department. In particular, Professor Ramesh Hariharan, who is still an adjunct faculty at this department, still takes courses. He's trying to bridge the gap between algorithms and biology, right? So what he's trying to do is, can we have more affordable healthcare, right? Can we get better treatment, or better still, can we have more preventive measures that are more effective, right? Can we predict that someone is going to have a disease at a particular point of time? So they're doing some really groundbreaking stuff at Strand Life Sciences, and this is an offshoot of the CSA department. Professor Narasimha Murthy, you might find his office this down this corridor, and one of his papers, which he co-authored, has crossed 9,000 citations, right? So one paper, so it has been used in over 9,000 papers, found this result of use, right? And that's a huge result, right? I don't know if many of you, are you, anyone of you aware of this news that Little Eye Labs, the first Indian company startup to be acquired by Facebook? So Little Eye Labs, so one of the co-founders, he was an ME graduate from this department. He did his compilers, he was working in compilers. And this Little Eye Labs focuses on program analysis. And Facebook found the work they were doing to be very lucrative. You know, they could encash what they have done. And they bought it for 10 to 15 million. That's a lot of money. So I had the privilege of meeting Lakshman, and he was like very happy to come back to CSA. And it's also a privilege to share this space with professors like Professor Narahari and Professor Narasimha Murthy, you know. So these are professors who are renowned worldwide for their results and for their research activities, and you get to meet them on a daily basis, and that's a rare privilege. That's one of the privileges you get at CSA, and very few places in the world will offer you this kind of an opportunity. And this is a news which I just posted in the morning. You can keep polling this CSA website. So one of the papers submitted at PACT, which is one of the top conferences, it has been shortlisted among 200 submissions. It's shortlisted as one of the best papers, right? And Shweta Jain, she has been the recipient of the Microsoft India Fellowship for 2014. And Pallavi Maya won the Google India Fellowship for 2014. And these are just in, the news just came in. And we are very proud of these achievements. So the distinctions of CSA span student distinctions and faculty distinctions. So students have won best thesis awards. They have won research internships at top research labs in India and abroad. And then you have these bunches of fellowships, right? So these companies feel that, well, this person is doing a research which really looks promising. So they can go ahead and fund them. And you have these Google Fellowship, Infosys Fellowship, IBM IRL, MS Microsoft Research Fellowships. You get a sizable amount of money, right? You just have to showcase your research. And if they're interested, then you get a lot of perks. Then you have Best Paper Awards, Best Poster Awards, and Yahoo Key Scientific Challenges Awards. So, I mean, these have made our department proud, and it's very competitive, right? I mean, getting one of these takes a lot of sweat. And students of CSA have been doing it on a regular basis now. When you come to research publications, books and monographs, you have 10 books and monographs, book chapters, journal and conference papers. These are typically the top tier on journal and conference papers. And you have, these are results which have a lot of impact. People are using these results, and that's what's more important. And among achievements, you have these prestigious organizations, these are mostly faculty achievements. So the Donald Knuth Prize is a very prestigious prize. Professor Ravi Kannan, who is a principal researcher at Microsoft and also an adjunct faculty here, he won it. And the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award, Professor Jayant Haritsa won it. And you have these prestigious organizations, and our faculty members were elected to these various bodies, like INSA is International Science Academy and Indian Academy of Sciences and so forth. So these are very prestigious honors. So I don't know, you've been here for a day or so, and you tend to look at CSA as this monolithic box, right? So what we're trying to do in this session is just open this box up a little and show you what goes on inside CSA. So you first have the faculty at CSA, right? So they are the people who teach you and get you involved in research and give you the problems. And then you have these programs. You know, we have these ME students, and you have an MSc branch, you have a PhD, bunch of PhD students, and you have a bunch of ME SSA students. And as you can see from the slide clearly, this makes CSA a five-star department, right? It's five-star, and there are very few departments which are five-star. But if you zoom out a bit, CSA has two aspects. There's a research branch and there's a fun branch. Right now, for exposition purposes, I have drawn them as separate stars, but they're really inextricably intertwined, right? So if you sort of prodded under the hood a bit, you'll find that there are really awesome artists who can draw a masterpiece on the canvas in no time. And then there are vocalists, violinists, sportsperson, footballers, quiz masters, writers, and you name it, there is in CSA. And it's a very vibrant environment. And the outcome is that you tend to spend more time in lab. And typically, if you join a company, you feel very happy when it's a weekend, right? Here we're very disappointed when it's a weekend because we want to stay in lab because that's where the fun is. You really grow as a person. You not only do research, but you do a lot of other activities. And that's why you tend to get involved in a lot of things and you grow as a person, right? But for the purposes of this talk, let's preserve fun. I mean, it'll be implicit throughout this talk, but we'll focus on research. But once you join, you'll have fun. So just join. So we'll outline the research areas first. So what are the research areas? Now, this has probably been outlined already. So there are three broad research areas in computer science, right? So there is theoretical computer science, there is systems, and there is intelligent systems. And so what you have is these big areas, they spawn several sub-areas, right? So for example, theoretical computer science, it spawns algorithms, complexity, graph theory, computational topology, algorithmic algebra, cryptology, and so you spawn these various subdomains, right? So similarly, intelligent systems has machine learning and reinforcement learning, game theory, cognitive science, and you have all these sub-areas. And typically in computer systems, you have programming languages, software engineering, architecture, database. So these are all sub-areas. But broadly, you have these three departments, these three divisions. But it's not watertight, right? There's a lot of osmosis which goes on between these divisions, right? So you'll find many faculty members are featuring in many bubbles. So you're free to come up with interdisciplinary problems, right? You can work on, you can apply machine learning in programming languages and vice versa. You can apply game theory in machine learning, and it's up to you. I mean, the limits are really up to you. So you're free to do a lot of experimentation. This is just more guidelines. So to get started on the courses, I'll ask Arpita to come and talk about the MA CSA program, and then we'll go on later on.
Hello, am I audible? Yeah, thank you, Shubham. I'm Arpita. So I'll give you an overview of what is this ME course program. So ME in Computer Science and Automation in ISC is one of the most popular post-graduation program that you get. And it's like there are really interesting and challenging courses. The entire ME program structure, it's a very well-structured program. You get deep learning on different aspects of computer science. And then also you get to interact with eminent faculties. These faculty members are basically PhDs and postdocs from from universities like MIT, Stanford, Princeton, etc. And then we have right emphasis on grades. That is, we don't give too much attention on grades or not too little attention. It's like, it's just balanced. Most of the people who actually joins this ME program, they are generally top rankers in their own colleges or universities. Now, all of them cannot be top rankers here, right? So, the main intuition is to enhance the quality of learning in them. It's not only about grades. So, we generally focus on this research. We try to tell them you get a good understanding of whatever courses you are taking, and don't just focus on how much good you are doing or emphasize on grades or anything. You have excellent research opportunities here because you have already seen all the papers, all the news about the publications and everything. So you have good research opportunities here. And also get to do projects in collaboration with industries as well as other foreign universities. And we also provide you extra guidance from two important persons. Like one is your faculty advisor. So they'll make your life smooth. They'll help you in interacting with this new academic environment that you are in. There's also a student advisor who will always be with you. You can, in a more informally and friendly way, you can interact with that student advisor always. Now, let us get into the eligibility criteria for joining this course. So, you need to be a BE or BTech in Computer Science or Information Technology. And from this year, it is, other disciplines are also allowed. So, you just need to have a good GET score in computer science, and but you can have any background, I mean any discipline, I mean BE or BTech you can have. And again, this GATE rank, yesterday you must have a session on GATE rank I mean what are the GATE criteria, eligibility, everything. So you have to perform really well in GATE. And also it is seen that generally the top 30 people of a batch generally has a rank below 40 in GATE, who actually enters IS in this program. Now let us look at the course structure. So the entire duration of the semi-course program is for 2 years. And we have this pools, which is like pool A, pool B, pool C, which is basically that theoretical computer science, that is pool A, in which you get this algorithms and complexity, automata, theory, etc. In pool B, you mainly have system courses like operating system, computer architecture, computer organization, etc. In pool C, it's basically intelligent systems. That is, you get to learn machine learning, game theory, and data mining, all these things. And this courses, like you have to take 10 courses in the span of this 2 years. So there are 4 semesters to take this 10 courses. And also you have a dissertation project. This project is basically is research oriented. You can also choose to collaborate with any industry, and you can take an internship and do the project under that particular company. And this dissertation project consists of 24 credits. And you can see, I mean, previously it was also shown that like nearly 72 of the dissertation works has been converted to publications. So a really good quality of dissertations happens. And for more information, you can always log into this academics courses section. You'll have a full details of every course that happens and what are the prerequisites of each of this course, etc. Now the prospects. Now what happens once you are out of this ME course program? So you have excellent placement opportunities. You get to, I mean, go to your dream companies like Google, Microsoft, Intel, Goldman Sachs, Amazon, etc. And also you also have a research scope. Like you can always choose to do higher studies in some of the eminent like universities of the world. Now this year it also happened like there were a lot of placements in research labs. So research labs, previously only PhD students were allowed, but this year there has been like over 20 ME people who got this research engineer positions in the research lab. So it's basically saying like you get a flavor of the industries as well as you have a scope to do research there. And so there are a lot of prospects that you get after you complete your ME course. And okay, I'll hand it over to Shiv Ganesh to speak about MESSA.
Hello. Thank you, Arpita. So. So I'm Shiv Ganesh, and I'll be here to talk about yet another master's program offered by the Department of CSA, which is the System Science and Automation. I'm sure you guys might have listened to some of the lectures yesterday on machine learning. So this course will be especially relevant to those guys who are like considering a career in the same area. So what exactly is MESSA? So MESSA is basically a master's course, just like CSA, but it's focused specifically on one of the research areas, which is intelligent system design. First of all, let's see how we get into MESSA. So it's similar to like MECSA. The admissions are based only on GATE's course. You get direct admissions offer, whether if you are in the top 50 or 100 ranks or so, depending on the departments. there's no interviews or whatsoever. And in addition, this is the extra feature of this program. This is offered in addition by the CSA department in collaboration with the electrical engineering department as well. So students need not be specifically from CS background. They can also be from other backgrounds, and you are eligible to apply even with your respective GATE's course. Of course, here all are CS students, so that's not an issue here. So as I said before, SSA is another master's program focusing specifically on intelligent systems. You can actually go for the intelligent systems research by taking MECSA as well. So how exactly is this different from the regular CSA program? So first of all, as I said before, this is a dedicated program exclusively for intelligent systems. in the sense that right from your first semester, you'll be allowed to take only courses which will be relevant for your research. And what I mean by a highly focused learning experience is because, as Arpita initially said, there are like certain pool requirements for the regular computer science course, in the sense that you have to complete at least 2 courses from each of the other research areas, but there are no such mandatory requirements here. So if you are really not so much interested into, say, compilers or operating systems, you need not spend your energy studying those subjects. Of course, it's always good to do extra subjects. And there are also research opportunities in the electrical department. So since this program, as I said, is offered in collaboration with the electrical department, you get to work on their projects as well. Some of their works are like on signal processing, computer vision, etc. And finally, the coursework. Here also, just like ME/CSA, you have to do 10 courses on an average, and you are eligible to do more as well. But unlike the ME/CSA program, here you can the coursework is extremely flexible. You can take courses from any of the other departments as well, say EC or math department. Finally, this course is mathematically rigorous, and of course all programs in IISc are mathematically rigorous, but here it's extra emphasis on mathematical modeling, say probability, linear algebra, optimization, because the reason is that these are the subjects which will form the core essentials for your 2 years of research. So unless you are good at probability, linear algebra, you will really find this difficult. So you have to be a master of those subjects. And coming to the list of projects, so I'm just giving a flavor of I'm just listing out just 4 projects just to get a flavor, just so that you get a flavor of what exactly is being done by SSA students. To be fair, there is actually no SSA specific projects. The projects are specific to departments, electrical departments or a computer science department. And you get to work with the professors and get their projects. So these are 4 projects which my friends from SSA are working on. So that's why I listed these 4. The first one is identifying cliques in large social networks. So as you know, like social networks like Facebook, Twitter, and say LinkedIn all have some kind of cliques or dense networks, sub-networks. So what exactly is that? Those users share some kind of related interest or something. So designing systems which can identify such cliques or dense networks helps us in user-targeted marketing, and it has many other applications as well. Then classifies from big data. So as you all know, this big data is a now commonly used cliche kind of thing. And so search engines like Google, Yahoo are in possession of huge amounts of data, say even more of terabytes or of bigger order. And designing classifiers, say a spam filter, from such a big, huge amount of data and reasonable amount of time and memory requirements is a challenge. So that is one other project which is going on. Then coming back to the same example of spam filters, there may be some malicious users who are deliberately misleading the classifier by labeling genuine mails as spam mails. So your algorithm should be robust to such kind of deliberately added noise. So that is yet another project. And this is one other project which is going on in the electrical department. This is basically designing a system which captures images as and when a person writes on a paper and can recognize each and every character on it. So these are just a small sample set of the projects on which the students of SSA are working on. So life after ME/SSA, as I said, again and again, SSA is yet another ME project. ME program offered by the Department of CSA. So after this, you can, just like anyone else, continue for a PhD in computer science. And if not, either in IISc or abroad, as was earlier mentioned by Arpita. And you can also go for research positions in leading research labs or MNCs. To be specific, there is no kind of any preference shown by these companies towards regular ME/CS students. ME/SSA and ME/CS students go for placements together. And there is no kind of bias or something. Two of my friends got into Google and Microsoft, so that is a testimony to my fact. And these are some of the companies. It's basically what Arpita earlier mentioned. And yeah, that's it from me. Next, I think Shubhamda will explain on.
So I have the privilege of talking about the PhD program. So we've done a bit of out of order instruction execution here. So MSc will come after later this. So we do PhD at CSA. So typically these days, you know, the first thing that when you talk about research, you talk about intellectual freedom. But then you come across these cartoons, right? So here's a very optimistic graduate student before he's joining a graduate school. He's saying, I want to do any research I want. Then the poor fellow joins a graduate school and he comes under an advisor and he says, I'm going to research on whatever my professor wants. And then once a graduate student becomes an assistant professor, there's a frantic running around and she has to say, well, I'm going to research whatever my tenure committee wants. And then the tenure once the person becomes a tenured professor, he's going to say, I'm going to do whatever research my grant committee wants. And then finally, when he becomes an emeritus professor, he's saying, I'm going to do research on whatever, and that's it. So he's researching in peace, or he's resting in peace, depending on your philosophical bend of mind. So what's the way out, right? So how do you get intellectual freedom, right? So I'm a big fan of Professor Jayant Haritsa, who's in the database systems lab. And he has a very unique take on things in life. So I sent him off a mail saying that, dear Professor Jayant Haritsa, I'm putting this comics. So can you give us a witty way of how can we get around this situation? How can we get intellectual freedom while doing research? So he sent me back this mail saying that, well, all you have to do is make up, you know, dress up what you're doing according to what's in fashion. And something like what this person Kiku Sharda did when he or she, I don't know, I've not seen this film, acted as Palak in Jhalak Diklaja, okay? Maybe he or she acted as a chameleon where you adjust according to the situation. And specifically in the 1990s, if you're doing research in pure graph theory to sell, you'd say you're doing research in transportation networks. And then in the 2000s, suddenly everything, these social networks came along and you said, you seamlessly switched to the social networks. You say, I'm doing research in social networks. And you can just, basically you're doing research on graph theory, maybe on clicks, and you say, I'm doing research in social networks. And this is the decade where you use the big data relationship to sell your research, right? So it's a new buzzword. You do anything you like and you put big data onto it, right? So, and it will sell. It will sell. So it's not like, but the work that you do will always remain the same. And this is coming from a professor who's won the Patnagar Award and he's done a lot of work. So it's kind of fun, right? So the idea is not just about, you know, this is about doing what you're doing and also selling it, right? So there's a managerial aspect involved in it as well. And this is just putting it humorously. But jokes apart, why should you do a PhD? Well, for intellectual freedom, right? So to get that intellectual freedom, if you have to do some stage performance, so be it. But you get that intellectual freedom. For the first time, probably, you're doing something you like doing, right? No imposition on syllabus, no nothing, right? So you choose what you want to do and you do it. And you get an in-depth understanding of the field of study, right? So you've picked a subject and now you go in-depth, right? You're trying to find out something which no one else on the planet knows. And that's a real kick. And so this, what is known, the state of the art is always like this expanding frontier of ignorance, right? As Richard Feynman often put it. And you have the chance to expand this frontier. And this is a privilege if you think about it very carefully. And it's a lot of fun, right? You read papers, you come up with ideas, and you run around saying, look, I've got an idea. And suddenly you become a very famous person. And you then win these fellowships and you get a lot of money and perks, things like that. So additionally, there are opportunities which PhD students get after they graduate, which are not always available to other degrees, right? There are opportunities which are very specific to PhD students, right? You can't become a professor with an ME degree. I mean, not in institutes like these, but there are opportunities which are exclusive to people who do a PhD. And you get to append DR in front of your name. So that's a big, I wanted to talk about how you get into PhD program. So there's a long convoluted thing about what qualifies you to apply, but I've glossed over those facts, but you can always go to this website, which is very nicely written. So rather than remembering this URL, you can just go to the quick links, you go to the home page, go to quick links, go to prospective students, and under that in the prospective student resources, you get this nice article that explains who all are eligible. In brief, almost anyone, right? So in fact, if you are a BE student or a BTech student, you can actually join directly to a PhD, like I have done, right? So you don't need a master student. So you're doing BTech, you join directly for a PhD. Just clear your gate cutoff score and you come for the interviews. So typically the process is, once you apply, based on a certain number of features, they shortlist you, right? And one of the criterion is the gate score, right? So you have to clear the gate score, right? So if you're typically from CS or IT, you're typically looking at a score like 670. If you're from some other stream, you look at a score like 680. So there are a couple of exams. I'm not really sure what these exams are, so I'm sorry about that. So, but typically, that score you should be targeting. And along with the gate score, there are other criterion as well. They bunch together and they shortlist a bunch of people. So what happens to this shortlisted set of people? Well, they come to ISC, they come to CSA, and they give a written test, right? And the written test is for 30 minutes. It's 10 questions, and it basically is the gate syllabus, right? You are asked questions on engineering math, you are asked questions on data structure, algorithms, programming, and it's fairly easy, right? It's not very difficult. So 30 minutes, 10 questions, and if you do well in that, you're called for an interview. Now, this is where the fun or the trip, I mean, fun starts. So you typically have a 1 hour interview. So, but the idea is the interview is not an elimination process. So probably for the first time in your life, you're appearing for something which is not an elimination process. It's an evaluation process. So typically when you've given the competitive exam, people are trying to eliminate you, right? But here, you have the opportunity to show what you know, right? You state upfront, look, I know these things, question me on these. And the professors are very fair in the sense that if you get stuck, they'll give you hints and you can progress. You don't even have to give correct answers. You just have to go and give the correct approaches. You have to write clearly. You have to be formal in what you're saying. For example, if someone asks you what is a language in a formal automator, if someone asks you what is a language, you don't write things like it's a bunch of strings. You just write it's a subset of sigma star, something like that. You have to be very formal in what you write, very precise. And for the first step, it's up to you, right? So the better you say, give your interview, it's all up to you. The better you give your interview, the better your chances. So typically what happens is, I'll show it in the next slide, but you have to pick a research area. It's typically one from theory, systems, or intelligent systems. Pick an area. Inside that area, you have to pick two sub areas, right? And in those two sub areas, you can pick two background subjects, okay? It's very simple. Pick an area, pick two sub areas, pick two background subjects. So the interview goes in the other way. You are asked first on these two background subjects. They test whether you know everything in these. If you do very well in that, they go on to the two sub-areas of research, right? They may or may not. Most of the questions will be from here. Now, if you do well, then you have a very high chance of getting selected. So, very high chance, actually. So typically, this is what it looks like. So you typically select one of these, right? Are you interested? Let's say you're interested in computer systems and software, right? So you pick one, and now let's say you pick a sub-area. So you pick programming languages and software engineering. So no guesses on what I work on, right? So obviously I work on these two. So now once you do this, you have to pick two background subjects, right? So let's say, what do I like? I like, let's say, engineering math and programming, right? So now the professors will start off by asking me data structure and algorithm questions and programming questions. If I do fairly well, they may go on to questions in software engineering and programming languages, right? They may ask you on related areas, automata theory probably. And this typically goes on for an hour. So this is entirely up to you. The preparation is very fundamental. They don't ask esoteric questions. It's very fundamental. They'll ask you like the nitty-gritty, the basics, the definitions, and they just test you on how you're approaching the problem. They give you hints if you get stuck. It's a very fair process. You don't have to be nervous. You don't need to do anything at all. You just go with the flow. If you get stuck, they'll give you hints. It's very fair. And it's going to be a very nice experience, actually. So after 1 hour, when you come out, you'll feel very good because it's going to be a dialogue. It's not that you'll stand there and you're just going to write things on the board. It's going to be a dialogue. They're constantly going to prompt you and things like that. It's a very nice process. I mean, and once you go through, it's a lot of opportunities open up. So once you get in, what happens after that? Well, the PhD process is sort of like a waterfall of things. So first you come in and you select your advisor, right? So as you saw that even on sub areas, many people are working on many things, right? So you choose whom you want to work with, right? So you go around, you ask, what are you working on? You go and talk to the lab members. You try to find out where you fit best, right? You're trying to find in which lab do you fit best, right? You get your peer group, you get your advisor. That's the first step. So typically in this process, you'll have to read a lot of papers. And during this process, you also have to take courses. So it gets a bit hectic, but it's up to you, right? You need to make these tough decisions, right? And once you do that, you have to complete what is called the research training program. It's called RTP. So it's just basically a bunch of courses. If you're joining directly after BTech, you have to do more courses. joining after ME, you have to do less courses. And after that, you basically give something called a perspective seminar. And it actually happens in this room. So what happens in a perspective seminar is, by this time, you've selected your advisor, and roughly you've selected what your problem is. And you just express your problem, right? You say that, look, this is what I'm going to work on. This is what I know about the problem right now. And this is why I think this is interesting to work on. And what the faculty do is, because they're more experienced, they'll give you feedback. They'll probably tell you, no, maybe this is not a very good idea, right? Maybe this is something that you need to change. So perspective seminar is where you get all the feedback from the faculty, you fine-tune your problem, and then you work in earnest. So then you give something called the comprehensive exam. So in the comprehensive exam, you're typically queried, it's like another interview, where you're asked on subjects you took in your RTP and on your research area, right? They want to ensure that you are a right fit for the problem you've taken, right? So it's not, there's no, if you, for example, somehow something goes wrong, for God forbid, and your comprehensive doesn't go well, they'll give you guidelines. They'll say, maybe you should modify it this way, and maybe you can come back after some period of time and give it again, right? So it's a very fair process. You have many chances to rectify and correct. So it's not one shot, right? So you have many chances. You must get it right, because you have so many chances. And then finally, you give the colloquium. So the colloquium is when you've finished your research, you've published many papers, and you've got your results. And now you express your results to everyone, right? Look, these are the results I've got. And then in the colloquium, people might give you more advice, that maybe you can do these things additionally, right, to make your thesis really wonderful. So you get more advice, and then you start writing your thesis, which my friend Saneem is doing right now. So he is writing his thesis, and once you have the thesis, it's submitted to these external and internal reviewers, right? So once they come back with their feedback, you sort of correct the thesis according to their feedback, and then you finally give the defense, right? And defense is when you get, defense is the last formality in this entire process, and you become a doctor after that, right? Of course, assuming that you have cleared your hostel and mess bills. So once that has happened, so you become, now you're free to add the doctor title to your name, right? So I must point out that this entire process of getting into the PhD and this flow of how this program goes is actually very similar with the MSc program as well, right? So MSc is just about doing a slightly less research, but the flow is basically the same, as Saneem will point out. Now, the added advantage of PhD is, let's say you get in as an ME program or an MSc program, and you find, well, research is my thing. I really like this thing, and maybe I want to take this further. So at any point of time, you have the flexibility of converting to a PhD program, at any point of time. So you get in as an ME, you start liking your work, you think, well, I'll do a lot of work on this, and you can convert. No problems, right? So you always have that option. So let's say you've done your PhD, you've done your defense, people have started calling you doctor, and what happens next? Well, you're now spoiled for choice, right? You have these bunches of places where you can go, right? You can either join as an employee, or you can go and do a postdoc. So you can go to Microsoft Research, MathWorks, Xerox Labs, and you have these bunches of universities. People have come back to IIT to teach, IISc to teach. People have gone to IIT Bombay, Kanpur, University of Texas, Austin, Virginia Tech, Yahoo Labs, HP Labs, Samsung, just to name a few. IBM IRL is another one. So you're literally spoiled for choices. You have the choice of either opting for industry or for academics, right? It's up to you. So that's about it. So for the PhD program, so I hope you enjoyed this session. So to take it into the last course, I'll ask Saneem to talk about the MSc course. So.
Hi all. I hope you can hear me, right? Yeah. So MSc at CSA. So this is a name which we got because of some historical background. We have this. This is actually an engineering course, even though it sounds like a Master of Science. So we actually call it MSc Engineering at CSA. Okay. So we are trying not to call it MSc Engineering. We will be calling it MS by Research. So this is more of a master's where you will be doing research. And I personally believe it's a convex combination of ME and PhD. So what is a convex combination? It is this ugly looking equation. Okay, yeah, I hope you would have gone through linear algebra and optimization. You would have seen this equation. But this is what I feel, I don't know if other members in department would agree with it. What I feel is MSc engineering is something like 0.3 times ME plus 0.7 times PhD. It is somewhere in between. So if I'm going to picturally show, like, it'd be like ME at CSA and somewhere there it would be there. Fine. Yeah, so why would I call it as a Cornell's combination? Because in MSc, you don't have to take as many courses as an ME student takes. So they will have to typically take some 12 courses or 10 courses. 10 to 12, right? Okay, 10 courses. And yeah, for MSc, we might have to take lesser courses, but we will do much research. We'll have more time sitting and reading research papers and thinking that we are doing research. Yeah. And yeah, unlike PhD, so in PhD what happens is you spend a lot of time doing research, we finish it a lot earlier. Okay, so now how to get into MSc engineering? It's exactly same as the PhD. As he told, like, you have to write GATE exam and you have to come for the interview, which he called is fun. And yeah, and you have to clear board. And the fun part is, like, when you're attending the interview, the professors would actually ask you if you want to do an MSc or a PhD. Okay, and yeah, so getting into MSc is the same as getting into PhD, the procedure. And yeah, duration of MSc, unlike ME, is 1.5 to 3 years, theoretically. Yeah, so hitting 1.5 is hard, and 3 is, yeah, most prominent ones. Yeah, so yeah, people in general on an average finish it in 2.5 years, and yeah, I would say that it isn't bad finishing it in 3 years. Yeah, I'm doing it now. Yeah, so number of courses, as I told, it'll be around 3 to 4, and as Shiv Ganesh explained, so we don't have pools here, but like we have more freedom. We have to take 4 courses, and it we take only courses which are related to our research area. So for PhD as well as MSc, the criteria is you have to take at least 2 math courses. Okay, so I have taken 4 math courses. Yeah, that's how it works. Okay, so now the good thing about MSc engineering, it gives a good understanding of research by just not doing PhD but still getting a good understanding of research, and it's like a best launch pad for PhD. The launch pad of DuckTales kind of thing, the launch pad for PhD. Okay, yeah, now, yeah, this is a question like MSc engineering versus ME or MTech. This is a question which I, the question which I regularly answer on every year, like, you know, it comes into May and March, there'll be calls coming like, hey, I got MTech in IIT Madras and MSc, should I come here to interview or something? So this is something which I keep getting this question, I get on a yearly basis. Yeah, so the question is, why should someone do an MSc? So this is the point. So if you are doing BTech and then you find some subjects really interesting and some subjects not so much interesting, we won't call it bad, but so not so much interesting, and you want to pursue a master's in that particular subject. So in my case, I did a BTech in electronics. So I want to do something on machine learning. So I came here, I took only the courses which needs for machine learning. Or if you are interested in theoretical computer science, just take graph theory or algorithms. So if you just don't want to learn about other things, okay, so then you have to hit MSc engineering. And one more thing is, you want to do research, but you're not sure if you want to do it for next 4 or 5 years. Okay, so this is more like, you don't know if research is what you, research for 4 or 5 years is what it is for you, but you can do just 2 years and figure out if it is actually you want to do it, and then you can do a PhD after that. Or as Shivam already mentioned, if you are halfway through MSc or any of these courses, like first semester, second semester, third semester, always you can switch to PhD. But just after another interview, you'll have another interview where you have to answer questions and still get into PhD. Yeah. And yeah, just to finish the placement. So this is the question I always get, the placements. People are always worried about placements for MSc engineering. You do have the similar opportunities as ME students in both CS and SSA. We have the same opportunities. People in MSc tend to take the work which they have done research on because you have spent 2 years just doing that. And one more thing is you can always attend placements on the end of second year or third year. So you have more opportunities. You feel that you are not ready after the end of second year, you can stay a little longer, finish the MSc, and then come, like, at the end of third year, you can come and do given placements. Yeah, and it's not just about placement. You can even go out and just give interviews and still get into company. It's not that difficult. Yeah, if you do all these courses well. Yeah, so back to Shivam. He'll
cheers.
So I'll just finish things off. Most of you are BE BTech students, but as you probably fathomed by now that BE BTech has limited utility, right? And because all of you are here, probably most of you have a lot of interest in research. So BE BTech has limited utility, but if you do an ME or MSc, you can go more places and do more things, right? So you get you have a larger window of opportunity. Just to give you a concrete example, Arpita and Shiv Ganesh have been placed in excellent research labs, and they were literally spoiled for choice choosing where to go. And Saneem has recently published in a top tier conference. So you get these opportunities if you do these ME MSc programs, right? And these are not available to you once you do a BE BTech. So but with PhD, what you get additionally is that you get excellent opportunities in both industry and academia. And you get a level of freedom which you don't get in other areas with other degrees, right? You get a great level of freedom. And with freedom, you get job satisfaction, joy of work, and this freedom just gives you the avenues to pursue other things that you like in life, right? You can do other stuff that you like. You have all the time in the world. So this campus has a very beautiful environment in general, but it has a very beautiful environment for research in particular, right? So you get to talk about research not just in CSA. If you go to any of these coffee boards and tea boards, and you get to meet people from other departments, right? And you get to talk to them about what they are doing. And this gives you ideas, right? And this is something that's close to you. It's not very far, right? It's near home. And it's world class. As you saw that these papers and citations and companies, what distinguishes this from any other world class university, right? There's the distinction is really blurring these days, and it's blurring very fast. So CSA is a wonderful place to work in, and PhD at CSA is a wonderful program to be in, as is ME and MSc. These are great programs to be in, and you get a lot of options, you get a lot of opportunities, and a lot of you literally be spoiled for choice after doing one of these programs. And so the idea is to take away, so the gateway to excellent opportunities to CSA. You get it? I mean, gateway. So. So the GATE is an exam you should be taking seriously because it opens up really nice opportunities for you here at CSA. And as I hope we were able to convince you that CSA is probably one of the best places to do one of these programs, not just in India, but all over the world, right? One of the stats which we probably forgot to mention is the top rankers of ME programs, they typically tended to go to the universities abroad, right? MIT or Stanford or University of California, Berkeley. But it has been happening consistently over the last few years that the top rankers, if you see the research admissions list of this year, and last year, and the year before, the top rankers choose CSA, right? They choose to stay behind because CSA is expanding, as you can see, not just in our infrastructure way. We are getting more professors, we are getting more research labs, we are getting more students, and it's expanding. And it's a wonderful place to be in. So with that, I would like to end it here, and we warmly welcome you to join CSA. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank Arpita, Shiv Ganesh, and Saneem for helping me out with this. And if you want, you can. There's a lot of ways you can keep in touch. You can busy poll the main website. There's an interact at CSA Google Sites where it's a forum. You can post questions, and we'll try to answer. But there is a restriction on what you can post as question. Then there is a Facebook page, CSAISC, which a lot of information is posted there. There's a big data lecture series which happens every month. Excellent lectures happen there. All the updates are at the Facebook page. There's a YouTube page where all of these videos will be available and previous videos are available. So try and keep in touch with one of these avenues. And now we come to the question section. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank
you. Any questions?
How many students get into this program every year?
So the numbers were probably given in the first slide in the, so I'm not sure of the exact numbers. I think the Yeah, so 60 is the number every year. MESSA is around 15. PhD, MSc combined will be around 21 to 25. So these are the rough numbers. But there are years when the intake is more. So the intake in the research programs typically depend on openings under professors, right? I guess ME is indirectly affected by that as well. So yeah, so but these are the rough numbers. If you talk about direct PhDs, I think the number is around 4 or 5 students are taken per year for direct PhD. I'm not sure of the, for numbers, I guess the better person to ask is Professor Narahari, because he gave you the slides. I guess he had the numbers on the slide. But I'm probably, yeah, you can ask in the forum, you can ask, because we don't have the exact numbers, but these are rough estimates, if that helps you.
And what is the average duration for PhD? I mean, it will vary after you do ME or when you come.
So that's a fair question. Now, like all things in life, this is up to you mostly, right? So if you really select an area where a lot of work can be done, you can finish off your PhD fairly quickly. Right, so average duration I guess would be around between 5 years and 5.5 years, right? So yeah, that's the time you should, I guess 5 years is the one you should be having in mind.
The 30-minute exam which you were talking about, which you have to come here, when is that exam conducted?
When is that exam conducted or where?
When is that exam conducted?
So these notices typically come out, I guess, in February, and between June, the first few days in June, something like June 2nd to first week of June, right? So typically around, let's say 100 people are called and they are given dates. So 20 come on the first day, 20 come on the second, and spread over 5 days. So in the first week, you'll be called, first week of June every year, you'll have to come and give this exam at CSA.
Like after we have completed our 8th semester?
After you've completed, yes. Yeah, your GATE result should be available by then, right? Yeah.
Any more questions? That's it, I think.
Okay, thank you very much.
So, thank you, Swoon. Thank you, Saneem and Shiv and Arpita.